إن الحسين مصباح الهدى والسفينة النجا صلوات من أكبر الله سبحانه وتعالى accept the azab Sayyid al-Shahada for this month which is now coming to its end. I begin with this hadith, famous hadith of the Prophet, where the Prophet describes Imam Hussain as Misbah al-Huda, the lamp of guidance, wa safinat al-Najat, and he is the ark of salvation. It's interesting that in the hadith that we have from our Imams, especially the sixth Imam, he says, Kulluna sufunun najat. Each one of us, the Imams, are safina of najat, ark of salvation. But then he says, Walakin safina to jaddil Hussein, awsa' wa asra'. But the safina and the ark of salvation of my grandfather Hussein is the most vast and the most fast. And this is where we come to realize that even among the Imams, Hussein ibn Ali has a very special status. And that is because of the sacrifice that he has given, the supreme sacrifice. And when we talk about the Azaf Sayyid al-Shuhada, yes, even these ceremonies that we have in Muharram and Safar, these are basically the lamps of guidance for us. These are in a symbolic way where we embark on the ark of salvation. Because when we sit down and think about Karbala, when we hear about Karbala, when we read about Karbala, basically this becomes an opportunity for us to refocus on our faith. Very much like the month of Ramadan, but here it is more on the emotional level. We are actually touched inside. And that is the power of the Azaf Sayyid al-Shuhada. And when we look at ourselves, you know, this becomes the time when we re-energize ourselves, recharge ourselves to become better practicing Muslim. Because Muslim by definition means somebody who submits to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everyone is at a different level of submission. You know, maybe 40%, maybe 50%, maybe 60%, maybe 75%, I'll say mashallah to that. You know, and so everybody during the month of Ramadan, when you hear about this supreme sacrifice, why Hussein did that, this is the time where we get recharged. Even the Aza itself, it's not only the process of grief. When we cry for Imam Hussain alayhi salam, it's not only aza in the literal sense that we are mourning and grieving what happened. It's actually a way of protesting against the zulm and injustice done to him and his family. Not only that, it's actually even more than that. It is actually an expression of distancing ourselves from the behavior of those who are zalimeen. You can't have tawalla without tabarra. Tawalla means you have to love Ahlul-Bayt and love those and their qualities. Tabarra doesn't mean you have to disassociate with the enemies of Ahlul-Bayt. You also have to distance yourself from the behavior of the zalimin. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, for example, when we talk about the thirst of Imam Hussain alayhi salam and his companions, his family, the women and the children, especially when we remember the incident of Sakina and Al-Yasghar. It's not a grief only. It's actually when you cry on that thirst of the Shuhada of Karbala, the women and children, it's actually we are making a pledge that if I find myself in a situation where there is somebody who needs water, I will never ever deny that person. Even if he's a kafir, it doesn't matter. Remember the example of Hur. When he came, not as a friend initially, Hussein ibn Ali didn't ask him, did you come as a friend? He actually provided water for the soldiers as well as the horses that they came on. And so we really have to think about it. You know, this whole concept of Sabil-e-Hussein. It is very common in many, many cultures. And from what I read during the time when I was studying the history of the Ottoman Empire, in some of these countries in the Eastern European area where Muslims were in large numbers, Yugoslavia, Albania, and other places, because of the Muslim influence, many of the water fountains in those villages were actually known as places for remembering Hussein bin Ali. And these were all not Shia people here. And so we have to realize that, you know, it's not only crying and grieving. We have to have that commitment, you know, to rise up and reach to a level where Imam would be pleased with us. Salawat padhne ke baad. Till the day of Ashura, we remember the tragedy of the Shuhada. But now we are moved to the second phase in the movement of Hussein bin Ali. And this is where, you know, again we focus on the suffering. There was suffering before till the day of Ashura. There was suffering even after that. But the intensity has increased. There is no issues of, you know, being hurt or killed now. But the level of suffering was even more higher. Because now we are talking about the injustice done to the women and the children. You know, putting them in chains and shackles, humiliating them thereby, parading them as prisoners in the bazaar of Kufa and Sham, without any abaya and without any maqna. Let me make a point here. It's not part of my topic tonight. I hear these days that, oh, it was against the Arab value and the culture of Arab to remove the maqna. Was it the value of the Arab culture to trample the bodies of the shuhada? To make the horses ride on the body of the grandson of the Prophet? These people went to that level. Don't come and talk to me about the Arab culture. Yes, even the abaya were taken, and even the maqani', these are the words in the riwayat. So let us not, you know, reduce, minimize the suffering of Ahlul-Bayt. When we sit down and cry about this suffering inflicted upon the women and the children of the Ahlul Bayt, that's also a time for us to connect ourselves and refocus on our commitment to the issue of maintaining the modesty. The most important value in Islam, the modesty of the eyes, the modesty of the dress, and the modesty in interaction with the members of opposite gender. Azadari is not just a slogan. It's not just, you know, shedding tears. These are all means to soften our hearts so that we can imbibe the message of the values for which Hussein ibn Ali and his family suffered. Otherwise, you know, their suffering would go in vain. But no, it will never go in vain. If we don't take benefit, there are thousands of people around who take benefit. You know, let me focus on this one ayat of Quran tonight when we talk about the issue of modesty, especially keeping the suffering of the Ahli Haram in mind. Salawat. In Surah An-Nur, ayat number 30, which is Surah 24, ayat 30, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet. And the beginning of that passage is very interesting. It says, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. O Muhammad, say to the believing men, the command is for the men, that they should cast down their glances. وَيَحْفَظُ فُرُوجُهُمْ And they should, protect their private parts. ذَلِكَ أَذْكَ لَهُمْ This is more purer for them as far as their akhlaq and behavior is concerned. Now this is very important when we talk about this issue of, the hijab of eyes. This ayat actually is about the hijab of eyes, and the beginning of the hijab of eyes is addressed to the men. And this is a very important issue because that is the beginning of all the problems. If we can control our eyes, if we can control what we see, then everything else will be in control. And it's amazing that one of the hadith Qudsiya that we hear from Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi wa sallam, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, beware of the eyes. If the eyes disobey you, you don't have to go here and there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have given you the eyelids, just close it. You don't need any medicine, no prescription, no appointment, no specialist, no counseling. Allah says, I've given you the eyelids. If you have a problem, if your eyes is not obeying your heart, close. And that is where the whole issue starts with. And this is where, we talk about this issue of hijab of the eyes. Then the next ayat, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ Then Allah says to the Prophet, addressing the women, يَغْضُضْنَا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ Same wording. But in feminine form. Ask the believing women to cast down their eyes. وَيَحْفَظُنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ And to protect the private parts. And this is where we see the similarities there. When it comes to the hijab of eyes, there is no difference between men and women there. And this is such an important issue that sometimes, we think, oh, this is weird. How do we practice it? How do we explain to others? We live in a country where majority of the people are Christian, or at least they are supposed to be Christian, if not practicing. Just tell them, go and look at your own Bible. Go and see what Jesus says. Actually, even Jesus in the Bible talks about the eyes of hijab of eyes, where he says, you have heard that it was said by them of the old time, that you shall not commit adultery. But I say unto you, this is Jesus talking to Christians and others, that whosoever looks on a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already in his heart. And so this issue of, controlling the eyes, casting down the glance, this is not only Qur'anic and Islamic, this is also, the teaching from the Christian faith and the Bible. Sometimes we have the meetings here, senior, administrations from the school board, even the police board, they come here on different issues. We talk about building bridges between our community and the institutions around. One of the issues I talk about is the interaction between genders. And I emphasize this point, that if you see a Muslim man and you are a lady, if he refrains from shaking your hand, don't take that as rude behavior or insult. Or if you see a lady is not shaking your hands with you as a male officer, no, this has to do with the sanctity which Islam has given to the genders. When a woman or a man who are not related to you by blood of marriage, they are not mahram, you're not allowed to touch them. And I actually link that with the issue of, sexual harassment that we see in the workplace. These days, a lot of discussion is there, where the seniors, use their position And now the women in this society are speaking out about it. Not only in a simple workplace, but even all the way to the Parliament Hill in Ottawa. Even MP, female MP ladies have now spoken clearly about it. That yes, this is a problem that we face. And of course, even if you go to the White House, the same problem. You go to the church in Boston, it's the same problem. So nobody is immune because Islam looks at the nature of the human being. The eyes is there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whenever it disobeys, just close it. And if you give in to it, then there are other implications which comes in. النَّظَرَةٌ فَابْتِسَامَةٌ فَسَلَامٌ فَمَوْعِدٌ فَلِقَاءٌ. According to one Arab poet, he says, it starts with looking. Is the first glance, and then the smile comes after that, and the hello comes after that, and the appointment comes after that, and there is musibat after that. And so everything starts from nadaratun, from the nazar, from the first glance. And Quran is very clear about it. These are human conditions which cannot change, whether you are in the 7th century or the 21st century. It is still the same. And so let us look at this issue of modesty. Quran is talking about it on a realistic level and not just superficial level. Salawat Quran ek baro. After talking about the hijab of eyes, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues. And he goes now into the dress code for women. وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَلْيُضْرِبْنَا بِخُمْرِهِنَّ عَلَىٰ جُيُوبِهِنَّ. And do not display their beauty except what is apparent. Especially when we talk about the face and the hands. And they should place their khumur over their bosom. I've not translated the khumur here. What does it mean? There was a reason for it. Khumur is an Arabic term. Of course, it comes from the Quran, which is in Arabic. And khumur is plural of khimar. And khimar, if you look at any translation of the Arabic dictionary, I'm not talking about the translation of the Quran, no. Go and look at any popular, classical, especially classical dictionaries, Lisan al-Arab, Majmu al-Bahrain, or even the most common dictionary in the Arab world known as Al-Munjid. You will see that the khimar is translated as something with which a woman conceals her head. مَا تُغْطَى بِهِ الْمَرْعَى رَأْسَهَا means the cloth by which the lady would cover her head. And when you look at this, the definition is very clear. The ayat of Quran is very clear that when there is a khumur, so it means covering of the head. But then, what does it mean placing the khumur over the bosom? This is where you have to look at the sha'n and nuzul, the context in which the Quran was revealed. The Arab ladies in Medina, even before Islam came to Medina, had a tradition of wearing khumur. But the way they would tie the khumur would go over their ears at the back, and they will tie the two ends of the scarf at the back. There is an article by a Muslim lady where she talks about hijab jokes. She has given different names to different kinds of, styles of hijab. And one of them is the Mickey Mouse hijab. Or the Minnie Mouse, we should say, probably. That would be the proper translation of it. And that is the pre-Islamic Medina style of the woman covering their head, but then going that behind their, over the ears, behind on their back. Now, Quran, the ayat, were revealed in Medina. And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? You already have the khumur, but now you put it on your bosom. So instead of tying it at the back, you bring the two ends to the front and put it on the front. And by doing that, you are concealing your ears as well as your neck and your bosom. And so when you look at this Quran, you know, the issue is quite clear. But I'll go again to another ayat, which is from Surah Al-Ahzab. Salawat. Surah number 33 of the Quran, ayat 59. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the Prophet, Ya ayyuhan Nabi, قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ وَبَنَاتِكَ وَنِسَاءِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. O the Prophet, say to your wives, your daughters, and to the women of the believers, what should you say to them? يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ. That they should let down their jalabib. What does jalabib mean? Jalabib is plural of jilbab. I'm sure those who lived in the Middle East know this term. And it refers actually to a loose outer garment which a lady would use. And this is also the meaning given in the most dictionaries of the earlier time and the modern days. A shirt or the dress which is wide. So basically, when you put these two ayahs together, you get actually the essence of what is known as the Islamic dress code for women. It doesn't only consist of the scarf. It covers the scarf, which goes down, covering the neck and the bosom, and an overall dress, which is long and loose. I have not even gone to a single hadith from the Prophet or the Imam of Ahlul-Bayt. Although I know all of you believe in that. The reason I'm focusing on that is because we have these days, mashallah, so-called Islamic experts who are not Muslims themselves. And they teach the Muslims that hijab is a cultural issue. It has nothing to do with your religion. And unfortunately, there are some sisters among the Muslims who say, yes, I looked at the Quran, the translation, and I didn't see hijab there. Therefore, I'm taking the hijab off. I'm just giving you the simple translation of the words, the khumur and jilbab used there in these two ayat. Put them together and you actually get the definition of what is known as Islamic dress code. And if you want to go into more details, you can go to how the Prophet understood this ayat, not the Western scholars living in the 21st century. This Quran was not revealed to them. It was revealed on the heart of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. You look at the Aimma who came later on, what do they say about these ayat? And so, you know, this whole issue of saying this is all cultural, no. The styles could be cultural, but the essence of Islamic dress code of haya is religious. The style changes from abaya to chadar of Iran to the parda of Afghanistan or the niqab, or you go to Indonesia, you go to Buibui in East Africa. The styles will change. You come to the Western world, there is a different way of, you know, expressing modesty. As long as the basic ruling which have been given in these two ayat are fulfilled, all these different forms would still be Islamic on the same level. Salawat. Sometimes we even have a problem of what we call not be hijabi, but bad hijabi. The word bad in Farsi and bad in English is the same. You know, where you have the scarf and then a tight sweater and tight jeans. But that is mockery of hijab. Look at the issue of jilbab. What does it mean? So go back to the Quran. Go back to the roots. And that is where you'll understand what is the importance of, you know, this Quranic teaching as far as, you know, explained to us by the Prophet and the Imams of Ahlul-Bayt alayhi salat is concerned. Salawat. The suffering that Ahlul-Bayt went through. You know, especially when we talk about Karbala. It was painful. Remember the pain of the women and the children of Ahlul-Bayt. It was no more the issue of hunger and thirst. Although it doesn't mean that from Karbala to Kufa and in Kufa and from Kufa to Sham, there was no problem of hunger or thirst. No, there was. But at a lesser degree. You know, I just recited an example yesterday in a majlis of somebody, in a private majlis, about the devotion of Bibi Zainab to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That even on the eve of 11th Muharram, what is 11th Muharram? The day of Ashura has passed, and then the evening we call Sham-e Ghariba. After that, the night which passed. And I said that in the majlis, that if somebody in that situation came to me and he said, Maulana, I was under so much pressure, I didn't do Maghrib and Isha that night. I would say, Allah will forgive you, but go and do Qadha. But Zainab, not only that, she didn't do Maghrib and Isha. On that eve of 11 Muharram, Zainab even did Namaz Isha. Look at that devotion. And this issue of hunger and thirst, even during the journey from Kufa to Sham, we have the riwayat from our fourth Imam, who actually says that I noticed that at a certain point in this journey from Kufa to Sham, you know, my aunt was doing Namaz al-Shab while she was sitting. And this was unlike her. So he goes to her and says, Aunt, what happened? I normally see you doing Namaz al-Shab in a normal way. You stand up. And she says, my son, you don't know that the bread we get is not sufficient for everyone. I give away my own share to the children. And now your aunt is not that strong enough to do the nafila of layl in the normal way. And so yes, the hunger was there. But the greater pain and suffering that Ahlul-Bayt went through is the humiliation of being taken not only as prisoners from one city to another and paraded as rebels. You know the hadith that even fourth Imam uses, he says, we were paraded like the kuffar from Daylam. You know, non-Muslim prisoners brought from the area beyond the frontier of the Muslim areas. And that is where we see the way it was done. And I have a narration here from a Sunni source, Sibt ibn al-Jawzi in Tazkiratul Khawas. Where he say, مُوَسِّقِينَ فِي الْحِبَالِ. They were tied by ropes. مِنْهُمْ نِسَاءَ وَصِبْيَانَ وَصِبْيَاتِ مِنْ بَنَاتِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. They were women and boys and girls from the family of the Prophet. عَلَىٰ أَقْطَابِ الْجِمَالِ مُوَثِّقِينَ. Even when they were on the camel back, they were tied. مُكَشِّفَاتِ الْوُجُوهِ وَالرُّؤُوسِ. Their faces and their heads were exposed. Allah Majlisi actually talks about this, and this is what I would like to really, for us to focus about it. When we talk about the modesty and hijab, you know, it's not the azar that we have in crying. It's actually a commitment to these women and the children of Ahlul Bayt that we will try our best to maintain that modesty which was taken away from you, where you were mazloom, but we are not mazloom in that sense here. Allama Majlis has a narration from Fatima bint al-Hussein that on the day of Ashura, when the tents were being looted And then they came for the chadar of the women and the ornaments of the women. She says, I saw one of the riders coming towards me. And I started to run away. And he came closer, and then he actually hit me at the back with a spear. And I fall down. And he basically took the ornaments away. By the time I came to my own senses, I saw my aunt was sitting there. And I just looked at her face and said, Ya Ammata, hal min khirqatin asturu biha ra'asi? Min ayun al-nuvar? Oh, aunt, is there any piece of cloth that I can cover my head away from these people who are looking at us? فقالت يا بنتاه وعمتك مثلك. Zainab says, oh, my dear child, why don't you look at my head? Even your aunt is in the same way. And so this was the level of zulm that Ahlul-Bayt have gone through. And when we remember that, we have to actually remember that by living up to the value for what they sacrifice everything. Especially when you look at the humiliation in Sham. When the caravan reached close to, you know, Damascus, they were made to wait, because they wanted to decorate the city to celebrate the victory of Yazid. People in large numbers, and according to a narration that I was reading today, many of those people were from the Ahl al-Kitab. They didn't know. They were just told that, you know, there was a rebel who fought against the Khalifa, and we are bringing their heads and the family. So they came in large numbers, jeering, shouting, and booing towards the Ahl al-Bayt. When they reached close to the gate of the city, Shimr Mal'un, he actually called the soldiers who were carrying the spears with the heads of the Shuhada. And he actually tells them that I want you to go and stand and walk closer to the camels which are carrying the women of Hussein. This Mal'un realized human nature. He knew that when people see the heads of the Shuhada, that would be the first thing that people will see. And their focus would be on that. But this Mal'un wanted that humiliation for the Ahl al-Haram of Hussein. And therefore he wants the spear should be brought there close to the camels, so that the people do not only look at the heads, but also the faces of Zainab, Umm Kulsum, and Umm Farwa, and Rabab. And this was something which Umm Kulsum could not take it anymore. She actually goes closer to Shimr with her request. Danat Umm Kulsum min al-Shimr faqalat fi ilayka haja. As a daughter of Hussain, think about it. The daughter of Fatima is going now to Shimr and making a request that I have a haja. And he says, what is it? What do you want? And she said, تقدم إليهم أن يخرج هذه الرؤوس من بين المحامل. Ask your soldiers to move away with the spears ahead of us, because we have been humiliated more than enough the way we are now. But this Mal'un actually reinforced his intention by telling the soldiers to stay in the position that he has put them. حضرت حسین، یہ جو مصائب ہیں اہل بیت کے، خصوصاً اہل حرم کے، یہ شہادت اور قتل سے زیادہ سخت ہے. اگر آپ کو حسین امام زین العابدین کا وہ جملہ یاد ہو کہ جہاں جب ایک بندے نے کہا تھا امام سے، کب تک آپ روئیں گے؟ اور جب امام نے کہا کہ یعقوب کا ایک بیٹا صرف غائب ہو گیا تھا، میری نظروں کے سامنے میرے گھر کے 18 افراد ایک دن میں قتل ہو گئے ہیں، اور تمہارا یہ کہنا ہے کہ ہم صبر کریں. اس شخص نے جرت کی ہے اور کہا ہے کہ مولا، لیکن شہادت جو ہے آپ کے خاندان کی عادت بن چکی ہے، جس پر امام نے کہا تھا تمہیں انصاف نہیں کیا ہے. ہمارے مردوں کا قتل ہونا اللہ کے خاطر ہماری عادت بن چکی ہے، ہمارے خاندان کی میراث ہے لیکن ہمارے گھر کی عورتوں کا بے مقن و چادر بازار کوفہ اور شام میں پھرایا جانا ان کی اس طرح سے تشہیر ہو یہ ہمارے خاندان کا ورثہ یا عادت نہیں ہے۔ عزتداران حسین ایک روایت ملتی ہے سعل بن سعد کی جو رسول اللہ کے صحابی تھے وہ کہتے ہیں کہ ہم بیت المقدس کی طرف جا رہے تھے راستے میں دمشق سے گزرے اور ہم نے وہاں دیکھا کہ بڑا سیلیبریشن کا سما ہے پوچھا ہم نے کیا تمہارے شام میں کوئی خاص عید ہوتی ہے آج کے دن تو ایک شخص نے کہا کہ کیا تمہیں معلوم نہیں ہے کہ ایک خارجی نعوذ باللہ ایک ریبل جو ہے اس نے خروج کیا ہے اور اس کو شکست ہوئی ہے لہٰذا اس کے سر اور کے گھر والوں کو لایا جا رہا ہے۔ تو سہل نے پوچھا اس ریبل اور خارجی کا نام کیا ہے اس نے کہا اس کا نام لوگ بتاتے ہیں حسین بن علی و فاطمہ۔ اس وقت سہل کہتے ہیں تم لوگوں کو شرم نہیں آتی ہے تم کس کو خارجی کہہ رہے ہو یہ رسول کا نواسا ہے یہ فاطمہ اور علی کا بیٹا ہے۔ آگے بڑھتے ہیں جہاں اس نے اشارہ کیا کہ وہاں پر وہ قافلہ آیا ہے قریب پہنچتے ہیں دیکھتے ہیں کہ ایک بچی نظر آتی ہے یہ حسین کے 4 سال کی بیٹی سکینہ تھی قریب جاتے ہیں وہ کہتے ہیں کہ بچے تمہارا نام کیا ہے اس نے کہا میرا نام سکینہ بنت الحسین ہے کہا ہم میرا نام سہل بن سعد ہے ہم تمہارے جد کے صحابی ہیں ان سے روایتیں اور حدیث ہم نے سنی ہیں کوئی خدمت ہو سکتی ہے تو بتاؤ۔ عزداران حسین اہل بیت کی مظلومیت کو آپ دیکھیں 4 سال کی بچی کی صرف ایک تمنا تھی کہتی ہیں کہ شخص اس سے اگر ممکن ہے تو یہ جو نیزے دار ہیں ان سے کہو کہ یہ محملوں سے دور چلے جائیں تاکہ نظر جو ہے ہماری ماں بہن اور پھوپھی کی طرف نہ جائے۔ عزداران حسین غالباً اسی وقت کی بات ہے کہ حسین کا سر جو ہے سورہ کہف کی تلاوت شروع کرتا ہے اس لیے کہ حسین سے بھی سکینہ کی بے بسی جو ہے دیکھی نہیں گئی برداشت نہ کر سکے آیات قرآن کی تلاوت کرتے ہیں تاکہ لوگوں کی توجہ جو ہے سر کی طرف ہو اور لوگوں کی توجہ زینب ام کلثوم کے چہرے سے ہٹ جائے۔ اس لیے جب بھی امام سے پوچھا گیا تھا کہ مولا آپ کو سب سے زیادہ اذیت کہاں ہوئی ہے امام نے عاشور کا ذکر نہیں کیا اکبر کا ذکر نہیں کیا قاسم کے لاش کے پامالی کا ذکر نہیں کیا اکبر اور اصغر کی بات نہیں کی حسین کی شہادت کا ذکر نہ کیا نواس رسول کے لاش کی پامالی کا ذکر نہ کیا بس 3 بار کہتے ہیں الشام الشام الشام۔ عزداران حسین ایک بہت ہی دردناک منظر اس وقت کا ہے کہ جب دربار یزید میں پیش کیا گیا ایک ملعون فاطمہ بنت الحسین کی طرف دیکھتا ہے اور یزید سے کہتا ہے حبلی ہادی الجاریہ اے یزید اس لڑکی کو مجھے جو ہے کنیزی میں دے دو۔ بس اس بچی نے زینب کے سہارا لیا پھوپھی جان یہ کیا بات ہو رہی ہے جس پر زینب آگے بڑھتی ہے کہتی ہے خدا کی قسم تو جھوٹا ہے نہ تجھ میں یہ ہمت ہے نہ یزید میں ہمت ہے۔ جب یزید نے کہا کہ نہیں اگر ہم چاہیں تو یہ کر سکتے ہیں اس وقت زینب کی شجاعت کو دیکھے کہتے یزید تیری ہمت نہیں ہے کہ تو یہ کرے مگر یہ کہ تو ہمارے جد کے دین سے خارج ہو جاؤ۔ اس وقت وہ ملعون کہتا ہے کہ تیرے بھائی اور بابا اور نانا دین سے خارج تھے۔ اس وقت زینب نے کہا کہ جو کچھ اسلام باقی ہے یہ میرے بھائی کا صدقہ ہے میرے بابا کا صدقہ ہے۔ الا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين سيعلم الذين ظلموا اي منقلب ينقلبون۔ خداوند اس قبلی بات قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خداوند ہمیں وہ معرفت دے علم دے اور ہمت دے کہ جن ویلیوز کے لیے محمد آل محمد نے اپنی عظیم قربانیاں پیش کی ہیں اسے ہم اپنے زندگی میں اپنے عمل میں اپنے کردار میں صحیح معنوں میں اس کو ہم قبول کر سکیں. خداوندہ جہاں جہاں شیعن علی ان کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ, جتنے تکفیری افواج ہیں ان کی تمام طاقتوں کو نیست و نابود فرما, امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما. ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم. ماتم حسین.